I thought something from myself. No problem.
Can start, Prabhu. I will again share the screen.
Okay.
Okay. Yes, Prabhuji.
तुम्हार शरीर मोरा प्रधान साधन ये शरीरे साधिमो आमी बहु प्रयोजन द कंटेक्स्ट ऑफ दिस चैप्टर इज दैट सनातन गोस्वामी कम्स टू जगन्नाथपुरी टू मीट लॉर्ड चैतन्य महाप्रभु एंड ऑन द वे आई डोंट नीड दिस वर्स नाउ On the way, Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, actually Sanatan Goswami comes to meet Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. And on the way, he sees Hare Krishna.
Yes, Prabhu. We are good.
Okay, I'm seeing different screens. I'm a bit confused.
Okay, no problem.
Yeah, sure. So Sanatan Goswami comes all the way from Vrindavan to Jagannathpuri. And on the way, he comes via Jharkhand forest, and because of drinking water which did not suit his body, Sanatan Goswami develops a disease. There are some boils all over his body, and Sanatan Goswami has some oozing sores all of his body. It's a lot of pus and blood is coming out of his body. So Sanatan Goswami felt quite awkward. Oh, like how can I serve Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu with this body? How can I serve Lord Jagannath with this body? Because I'm coming from like a place where I had contact with Muslims and all that. I won't be allowed within Jagannath Puri temple. So I can't take Jagannath's darshan. And with this body, I won't be able to render service to Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu also. So my body is waste. My life is waste. So what is the use of a life that cannot be utilized in Krishna's service, Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu's service? So Sanatana Goswami even contemplates committing suicide after going to Jagannath Puri. Okay, anyways, I have planned to give up my body. So let me finally go to Jagannath Puri once and see Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, take his darshan, and then I'll give up my body. And I will also see Jagannath Rathyatra. On Rathyatra day, I will throw myself under the cart of Lord Jagannath. And in that way, I can give up my body. Because in Jagannath Puri, when Rathyatra is going on, so many people are there and a lot of crowd. So Sanatana Goswami made a suicide plan, how to give up his body. So Sanatana Goswami had made up his mind and reached Jagannath Puri. So when he came to Jagannath Puri, he went to Haridas Thakur's place. So Haridas Thakur has very cordially received Sanatan Goswami, and they both stayed together for a while. And then Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, as usual, he came to meet Haridas Thakur. And Haridas Thakur told Lord Chaitanya that Sanatana Goswami has arrived to Jagannath Puri, and Mahaprabhu became so ecstatic to see his dearest devotee Sanatana Goswami. Actually, Rupa Goswami and Sanatana Goswami are the foremost of all the Goswamis, and Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu had a lot of affection and respect for them, because through them Mahaprabhu would be propagating the science of bhakti and excavating the holy places of Vrindavan also. So, Mahaprabhu gave his association to different devotees in different ways. And his preaching and the way he gives association is different with different devotees. For example, when he meets Sarabhaum Bhattacharya and Prakashananda Saraswati, this kind of big scholars, Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu would be speaking philosophy, deep Vaishnava philosophy, and about Lord's energies and lot of analysis and all that. And when he meets Ramananda Rai and Swarup Damodar Goswami, Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu would be discussing about very esoteric leelas of Radha and Krishna and the gopis of Vrindavan. And when Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu meets Rupa Goswami and Sanatana Goswami, he gives them the teachings of bhakti. He teaches about the five rasas and different angas of bhakti, Vaidhi Sadhana Bhakti, Raganaga Bhakti, and Ragatmika Bhakti. All these kinds of teachings he will give them. And when he meets common people, Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu just performs Harinams and Kirtan and engages them in chanting the holy name of the Lord. So like that, Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu is associating with, or he is giving of association, his association to people, his devotees and common people is little different according to what they deserve and what they are meant to be doing. So Sanatana Goswami is one of the most confidential associates of the Lord in terms of propagating the bhakti culture. So Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu did not like the idea of Sanatana Goswami's attempt to commit suicide. So he knows that. So Sanatana Goswami stayed there in Jagannath Puri for a while, and Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu was coming to Sanatana Goswami's place and Haridas Thakur's place on a daily basis. And one day suddenly Mahaprabhu said that, Sanatana Goswami, if I can attain Krishna Prema by committing suicide, I am ready to give up my body hundreds of times. Sanatana Goswami didn't get the connection. Why Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu suddenly speaking like this? So then Sanatana Goswami suspected, did Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu understand that I am planning to commit suicide? How did he know? Let me open the shloka. So Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu said in the 58th shloka that bhakti vina krishna kabhu nahe premodai, prema vina krishna prapti anya haite nahi. So only by performing bhakti or devotional service unto Krishna that one can awaken Krishna prema, premodai. Prema vina krishna prapti anya haite nahi. So without prema, how can one attain Krishna? So without prema, Krishna prapti is not possible. So one cannot get Krishna without prema. So prema will help you attain Krishna and not committing suicide. So Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu just completely dismissed the plan of Sanatana Goswami. नीच जाति नहे कृष्ण भजने अयोग्य सत्कुल विप्र नहे भजने र योग्य. So in the 66th shloka, Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu says that low birth is not a disqualification, because Sanatana Goswami was also contemplating that, I am low born, nicha jati, nicha sanghi. So I have been associating with low born people. So I am not qualified to perform bhakti of Krishna. But Mahaprabhu systematically smashes all the so-called speculations of Sanatana Goswami. Actually, it's not that Sanatana Goswami does not have the right understanding of who is a qualified person for bhakti. If some other low-born person comes in front of Sanatana Goswami, or if some other person who is in diseased condition comes to Sanatana Goswami, Sanatana Goswami can certainly advise him that no, don't plan to commit suicide. It's not a disqualification to perform bhakti. So low birth is not a disqualification. You can perform Krishna bhakti. So he would, Sanatana Goswami can suggest others. But because Sanatana Goswami himself is in that condition of a diseased body and low association, out of his humility, he is thinking that, I will not be able to serve Krishna. So my body is waste, like that. So then Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu continues to speak to encourage Sanatana Goswami. He says, Yehi bhaje sehi vada abhakta heena chhar, Krishna bhajane nahi jati kuladi vichar. So anyone who takes to bhakti is exalted. Okay, in performing Krishna bhakti, there is no consideration of kula and jati. Your caste and your dynasty, your family status is are of no relevance to Krishna if you have love for Krishna. That's very clear. So Krishna is always favorable to humble and meek people. So I think last few days we must have discussed all this. I'm just giving a recap. Then Sanatan Goswami, in the 74th and 75th shlokas, he says, my God, Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu is very exalted in understanding my moods. Then in the 76th shloka onwards, Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu starts speaking to Sanatan Goswami about Sanatan Goswami's future services. Can I have the Bengali here in the 76th shloka onwards? Bengali, it's instead
yes,
of
I'm doing English. Sure, I'll do it right.
Okay.
Okay, one second.
प्रभु कहे तुमार देह मोर निज धन तुमी मोरे करिया छे आत्मसमर्पण. सो लॉर्ड चैतन्य महाप्रभु सेज दैट ओ सनातन गोस्वामी योर बॉडी इज माय प्रॉपर्टी. तुमार देह मोर निज धन, योर बॉडी इज माय प्रॉपर्टी. तुमी मोरे करिया छे आत्मसमर्पण, बिकॉज यू हैव कंप्लीटली सरेंडर्ड टू मी, यू हैव डन आत्मसमर्पण, देयरफॉर you have no more claim on your body. So Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu very clearly says that when someone dedicates one's life and one's powers or whatever one has in one's disposition in Krishna's seva, then Krishna considers that devotee as one's own. So we have another beautiful shloka in CC, that Diksha Kale Bhakta Kare Atma Samarpan. So it's not here, somewhere else. So Diksha Kale, at the time of spiritual initiation, a devotee does Atma Samarpan, means a devotee offers oneself to Krishna, oneself to Guru's service. At that time, Krishna considers the devotee's body to be one's own, and the devotee's body will become spiritual also. Now Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, now we can discuss from Prabhupada's purports in the fifth canto of Srimad Bhagavatam, where he can intermittently show this shlokas once in a while. So Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, he says that Sanatan Goswami's body is spiritual, although the body apparently is using some substances like pus and blood, etc. Still, Sanatana Goswami's body is spiritual. Why? Actually, in the fifth canto of Srimad Bhagavatam, Prabhupada says that, he quotes this shloka and then he says that we have this body, cross body, made of earth, water, fire, air, ether, and we have subtle body made of intelligence, ego, and mind. So, the gross body just follows the dictations of the subtle body. So the subtle body stores all kinds of desires and identities and impressions and plans and schemes and other things. And the gross body just becomes a subservient of the subtle body to fulfill all those plans. Now, when somebody takes an initiation from a guru, spiritual master, and follows the instructions of a bona fide Vaishnava guru very sincerely, then what happens is, that a devotee, by following the instructions of Guru, slowly spiritualizes one's subtle body. What are the activities of mind? Mind's activities are thinking, feeling, willing. So the devotee, after initiation by following Guru's instructions, starts thinking, feeling, and willing to do Krishna's service. All his thoughts are directed towards Krishna, remembering Krishna's Nama, Rupa, Guna, Leela, and all his mind's desires are directed to rendering service to Krishna. So that is the glory of spiritualizing the mind. And how does the intelligence get spiritualized? So when one follows the instructions of Guru, the intelligence which is constantly planning and scheming to have sense enjoyment starts planning and scheming for Krishna service. And thus intelligence gets spiritualized by following the instructions of Guru after initiation. And ego, which constantly identifies oneself with so many material designations like man, woman, Indian, American, Brahmachari, Grahastha, then Kshatriya, Brahmana, like there are hundreds of designations may be there, which are all temporary pertaining to the material body. Naham vipro na cha narapatir, naapi vaishyo na sudro, naham varni na cha grahapatir, no vanastho itirva. So one is not a Brahmana, Kshatriya, Vaishya, Sudra, Brahmachari, Vanaprastha, Grahastha, Sannyasi. One does not have any of these designations. The original designation that every soul has is Jivera Swarupa Hai Krishner Nitya Das. Every Jiva is an eternal servant of Krishna. Gopi Bhartu Padakamalayor Dasa 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 Anu Dasa. That is the designation of every Jiva. So the false ego, instead of identifying with so many material designations, starts identifying oneself as servant of Krishna. Thus, after initiation by a guru, when the disciple sincerely follows the instructions of bona fide guru, then one's body, one's mind, intelligence and ego are spiritualized. The subtle body gets spiritualized. When the subtle body gets spiritualized, the gross body, which is actually a servant of the subtle body, which is a follower of subtle body, also gets spiritualized. Practically, this gross material body engages in spiritual activities following the dictates of the spiritualized subtle body. Thus, although the gross body is material, it's acting on a spiritual plane. And it's just a matter of time before the conditions or before that sadhaka, initiated devotee, gives up this gross material body and attains a proper spiritual body in the spiritual world to continue his eternal service to Krishna. So that's how one needs to understand that by taking initiation from a spiritual master, one dedicates one's gross and subtle bodies to Krishna, Krishna's service. Then Krishna considers the body of his devotee to be his own. As Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu is saying that, oh, Sanatana Goswami, your body is my body. Your body is my property and you have no claim over it. So you cannot claim. So, 69, which sloka we are discussing, 76. So Mahaprabhu says that your body is my body. So why do you want to destroy someone else's body? Oh, Sanatana Goswami. Parera dravya tumi kene chaha vinashite dharma dharma vichara kibha napara karite. So parera dravya kene chaha vinashite means why do you want to destroy someone else's property? Dharma dharma vicharnahi. Don't you consider what is dharma and what is adharma, what is right and what is wrong? Don't you have the discrimination? So vichara kibha na pare karite. You are such a learned pandit. How can you not have this discrimination of which one to destroy and which one to protect? So your body is not your body. It is my property. How can you destroy my property without my permission? Tomara shariram mora pradhana sadhan ye sharire sadhimu ame bahu prayojan. So here is the key shloka where Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu actually reveals his own plans for the future activities of Sanatana Goswami. Tomara sharira means your body. Mora pradhana sadhan, it is my prime instrument. Sadhana here is not the practice of bhakti. Sadhana here is an instrument, a tool, my principal instrument. Ye sharire sadhimu, through this instrument of your body, sadhimu, I will achieve. Ami bahu prayojan, I will achieve so many tasks. I have so many plans to execute through your body. I will make you write books. I will make you excavate holy places. I will do this, I will do that. All these Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu is saying. So basically, when a devotee renders service to Krishna, or when a devotee is willing to render service to Krishna, Krishna will empower the devotee to extract whatever service that he wants to take. So when we are rendering some seva, please understand, it is not our glory. So in this connection, there is one purport by Prabhupada in the first canto of Srimad Bhagavatam, 15th chapter. So maybe I will share the screen. I'm just opening my folio. So I think I will read, I can summarize also, but I will read the direct statements of Prabhupada in the purport so that we can understand this. I think this is from first canto, 15th chapter, 5th shloka. Vanchitoham Maharaja Harina Bandhurupina. I'm sharing my screen. Yeah, this one. You can see. Vanchitoham Maharaja Harina Bandhurupina. Yena me pahritam tejo deva vismapanam mahat. So this shloka says that Arjuna was lamenting because Krishna has disappeared from this planet. So, and Arjuna lost all powers, right? So, Harina Bandhurupina, the Lord appeared as my dearest friend or relative. Yena me apahartam teja, but when he disappeared, all my teja is gone, apahartam. Deva vismapanam mahat, although with this prowess I have mesmerized even great demigods like Shiva and Indra, still I have lost all that power now. So Prabhupada writes, I'll just read specific statements only, not the full purport. Prabhupada says that when the Lord descends on the earth along with his eternal liberated, ever liberated associates, he not only displays the divine energy possessed by himself, but also empowers his devotees with the required energy to execute his mission of incarnation. So now Prabhupada says that Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu has descended with a mission to spread the holy name, to spread the science of bhakti. And of course, he has his own internal personal reason to experience the mood of Srimati Radharani. So now he descended with his eternal associates, Rupa and Sanatana Goswami, who are like Manjaris, and Sanatana Ramanandarai Sarvabhudhamur Goswami, who are like Sakhis. So Lord Chaitanya descended along with his eternal associates. And through those eternal associates, Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu will perform so many pastimes, so many tasks he has to perform. And powers are given to the devotees to execute those services allocated to them by the Lord. And once the services are completed, the Lord will take away those services. So one should never think that we are doing services by our own prowess. It is Krishna who bestows that necessary empowerment and energy on all of us to perform those services. So here Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu is clearly telling Sanatana Goswami that through your body, I am going to perform so many activities. I will extract so much of work from your body. So means the Lord is enabling. So our Sanatana Goswami also says in one of the previous shlokas, Sarvagna Kripalu Tumi Ishvara Swatantra Yaichena Chavata Aichena Che Yena Kashta Yantra. So our Sanatana Goswami says that, oh Lord, you are omniscient, Sarvagna Kripalu, you are so merciful. Tumi Ishvara Swatantra, you are Ishvara, the supreme controller, Swatantra, you are completely independent. Yaiche nachau taiche nachi. The way you make me dance, I will dance in that way. Yena kashta yantra. I am like a wooden doll in your hands, and you are pulling the strings and making me dance. So this is all your wish. So you make me dance. Nicha adhama pamaramui paramas pamaraswabha moreji yaile tomara kibahabe labha. So what is the use of making me live, keeping me alive? But Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu reveals that I am going to do so many things through you. Just like Lord Krishna enabled Arjuna to win the Kurukshetra battle. And also Lord Krishna enabled Hanumanji to cross over Lanka ocean and then retrieve Sita Devi and then fight war in Lanka. So in this way, Lord in his various incarnations enables his devotees to perform very uncommon deeds, superhuman activities also. It's all done by the empowerment of the Lord. We should not be taking credit. So as I say, when a crow takes some peacock feathers and puts in its tail and says, oh, I'm so beautiful, it just makes a fool out of oneself. Similarly, when a devotee thinks that I am accomplishing all these things, I am the doer of all these things, so that is not the consciousness which is appreciated by Krishna or any other devotees. So Krishna empowers a devotee, empowers a humble devotee to do so many things, and devotee gives credit, transfers all that credit to Krishna, and Krishna likes to see those sincere devotees being glorified. That's why Krishna is also called Prabhave Sarvasatvatam. Means Krishna, likes to expand the glories of his devotees. So Krishna likes to see his devotees more and more glorified and popular. So that's why Krishna is called Sarva Saundarya Sangraham. Snigdha Pravrudghanashyamam Sarva Saundarya Sangraham. Charva Yata Chaturbahu Sujata Ruchirananam. So Krishna is called Sarva Saundarya Sangraham in the Rudra Gita portion of Bhagavad Gita, fourth canto of Bhagavatam, 24th chapter, this shloka comes. Sarva Saundarya Sangraham means Krishna is the collection of all beauties. And Krishna is physically very beautiful. His collection of all beauties means there's a lot of beauty in the material world. There's unlimited beauty in the spiritual world. If you put all the beauties together, they are emanating from Krishna. And Krishna is the source of all those beauties, and Krishna is the personification of all those beauties. He is the origin of all those beauties. And that is the beauty of Krishna's physical form. But another aspect of Krishna's beauty is the beauty of his character, beauty of his heart. What is that specific beauty of Krishna's heart? He gives more credit to his devotees than he takes for himself. He enabled Arjuna to win the Kurukshetra battle, but he himself acted like a chariot driver and supporting all the Pandavas. But Arjuna is the hero of Kurukshetra. Similarly, Bhima killed all the 100 sons of Dhritarashtra, but Krishna was just driving the chariot. So Krishna made his devotees the heroes of Kurukshetra battle while he played the insignificant role of being a driver. So similarly, Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu predicted that my holy name will be chanted in every nook and corner of the world, but that credit goes to Prabhupada. And here Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu personally wrote only 8 shlokas of Shikshashtakam, but he enabled Rupa Goswami and Sanatana Goswami to write unlimited shlokas. Unlimited scriptures, so many books they have written. So Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu initially located where is Radhakund when he went to Vrajabhumi first time. But later he could not stay in Vrajabhumi. He went there and then came back to Jagannathpuri and continued to stay in Jagannathpuri only all the way. But he told the Goswamis, 6 Goswamis, to go to Vrindavan and excavate all the holy places. Especially Sanatana Goswami and Rupa Goswami, they went there and wrote so many scriptures and they erected temples and excavated holy places. So here Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu is enabling his devotees to become authors, to become temple presidents or whatever, excavators of holy places. But he himself is just staying in Jagannath Puri, just inspiring other devotees. So the Lord gives more credit to his devotees than he takes for himself. So what all services that Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu wants Sanatana Goswami to do? So let's go to the next shloka. That is 79th and 80th slokas. Bhakta bhakti krishna prema tatvera nirdhara vaishnavera kritya ara vaishnava achara. Bhakta means a devotee. Bhakti means the process of loving devotional service unto Krishna. Krishna prema tatvera nirdhara. Krishna prema is love of Krishna, love of Godhead. Tatvera nirdhara means Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu will establish the tattva or the real truth or the basic principles of bhakta, bhakti and Krishna prema. Bhakta, bhakti, Krishna prema, tattvera nirdhara. Next, vaishnavera kritya ara vaishnava achara. And Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu also establishes vaishnavera kritya means the duties of Vaishnavas. Vaishnava Acharya, the characteristics and etiquettes of all Vaishnavas. So all that Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu will establish through Sanatana Goswami. Here the point is Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu has a desire to establish all these principles and reveal the truths of all these items like Bhakta, Bhakti, Krishna Prima, Vaishnava Acharya, Vaishnava Tattva, Vaishnava Kritya. All that Mahaprabhu wanted to establish in this world through spiritual literatures like Bhakti Rasamrita Sindhu, Hari Bhakti Vilasa, Upadeshamrita, etc., etc. But all this he will not do personally. He will enable his devotees Rupa and Sanatan to do. So Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu says that your body is the pradhana sadhana, the principal instrument in my hands to fulfill all my desires. So I want to establish and ascertain the principles of Bhakti, Bhakta, Krishna Prema, Vaishnava Kritya and Vaishnava Achar. Please, don't give up your body. So next he also says, Krishna Bhakti, Krishna Prema, Seva Pravartan, Lupta Tirtha Udhara, Ara Vairagya Sikshan. Krishna Bhakti, the process of devotional service unto Krishna, which is performed in different rasas. In the initial stages, where one is following the regulative principles of bhakti, as recommended by scriptures and guru, that bhakti is called Vaidhi Bhakti. And when one is little advanced, he can do Raganuga Bhakti, or Raga Bhakti, where one does not perform all the practices of bhakti just because they are recommended by the scriptures. He will perform bhakti out of spontaneous love, spontaneous interest. So that is the bhakti. So Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu says that I want to establish bhakti, Krishna bhakti, Krishna prema seva pravartan. And I also want to establish centers for cultivation of Krishna prema. Means temples. So a temple is a center for cultivating Krishna prema. So temple is a place where we are supposed to endeavor and get inspired to develop our dormant love for Krishna. And Sanatana Goswami, Rupa Goswami are supposed to establish so many temples like that for common masses to come and take darshan and get connected to Krishna. Then Lupta Tirtha Udhara. Lupta Tirtha means those tirthas or those holy places that became inaccessible to people because of Kali Yuga or whatever. So they became quite inaccessible to people. Lupta Tirtha Udhara, we have to excavate all the lost places of pilgrimage. And Vairagya Sikshan. And also Sanatana Goswami is supposed to teach people how to adapt to the renounced order. Means they had so much of wealth, but they have given up all the wealth just to live in simple clothes in Vrindavan under some tree and then write books for the humanity, for the welfare of the humanity. So now Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu says, let's go to the 81st shloka. How many shlokas I am supposed to take? Up to which shloka?
Up to 92 you can go, Prabhu.
Up to 92. Now I'm in 81. So 81. Nija priya sthana mora mathura vrindavan tahayeta dharma chahi करीते प्रचारण. सो ही सेज दैट माय डियर सनातन गोस्वामी, माय मदर ऑर्डर्ड मी टू स्टे एट जगन्नाथपुरी. So I can't go to Mathura and Vrindavan. So Mathura and Vrindavan are like my own dear abode, and I want to do so many things there and preach Krishna consciousness. But my mother told me, "You stay at Jagannathpuri," because Jagannathpuri and Navadvip are like two rooms in the same house. So the devotees at Navadvip would go to Jagannathpuri to take darshan of Lord Jagannath. And the devotees at Jagannathpuri will come to Navadvip to take bath in Ganga. So there will be a lot of communication between these two places, and Mother Sachi can hear about Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu who is staying in Jagannathpuri. So she requested Lord Chaitanya to stay at Jagannathpuri. So because of that order, Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu cannot go to Mathura and Vrindavan, although it is his dear abode. So he says, in the next shloka, matara agnaya ami vasini la chale taha dharma sikshayate nahi nija bale. With the order of my mother, I am sitting in Jagannathpuri, therefore I can't go to Mathura Vrindavan. Next, eta sabha karma ami ye dehe karimu taha chadite chaha tumi kemane sahimu. So I have to do all this work through your body only, because I can't go there to Vrindavan. You have to be there. So, but you want to give it up? How can I tolerate this? Oh, Sanatana Goswami, I can't tolerate this. Taha chadite chaha tumi kemane sahim means, how can I tolerate? So I won't be able to tolerate your decision of giving up your body. So then Sanatana Goswami became quite astonished to see all the plans of Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu for himself. Now, like as the future verses and other sections of this chapter might reveal, that Sanatana Goswami had this oozing substances on his body. So he felt so awkward. So that's why Sanatana Goswami did not want to maintain this body anymore. This is anyways diseased body. With this, I can neither see Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, I can never see Lord Jagannath, or I cannot serve Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. So what is the use of this body? Then I will just give up this body. So the body is not meant for sense gratification. The body is meant for rendering service to Krishna. And if that body is not suitable to render service to Krishna, devotee doesn't feel like staying in that body anymore. But Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, by his great mercy, he will make Sanatana Goswami's body suitable and healthy now. And although Sanatana Goswami is saying, "Oh Mahaprabhu, please don't touch me. I'm so contaminated. When my source and all that pus is touching your transcendental body, I feel so awkward. I feel it's very sinful and offensive on my part to even have your body touched by my, contaminated things that are coming out. So I feel so awkward. So please don't touch me. But you are forcefully embracing me so many times. I can't be seeing this anymore." So Sanatana Goswami felt quite awkward. So later Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu says that just like a small baby who is held by mother, in the lap of that mother, if the small baby passes stool or urine, so mother will not feel disgusted by that. Mother will feel that, "Oh, my son, my baby is taking food and digesting it nicely and passing stool." So mother feels so happy that the child is passing stool. And she can, with her own hands, she will clean the, all the stool of the child. And she will not get disgusted with all that. So she will even feel that this is chatushma. Chatushma means a mixture of so many fragrant substances like sandalwood pulp, agaru, musk, etc. So stool is not very fragrant. But mother considers her child's stool to be like that, and she would not have any disgust. Similarly, Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu considers Sanatana Goswami as his own child. And I am your maintainer, I am your protector, I am like your father. How can I feel disgusted by touching you? although you may be having some some disease, so I don't consider your body diseased. And even otherwise also, the Vaishnava's body, although it is diseased or deformed, it is never subjected to any criticism. As we studied in Nectar of Instruction or Upadeshamrita, it's very clear that one should never look at a Vaishnava's body from material perspective. That's an offense. I think it's somewhere in the 7th shloka or 6th shloka of Nectar of Instruction, that one should never look at a Vaishnava's body from a material point of view. Oh, this Vaishnava is thin, fat, lean, fair, dark, etc., etc., Indian, American. So these considerations are not supposed to be coming in the mind of people who are looking at Vaishnava, people who are seeing a Vaishnava. So Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu showed so much of affection to Sanatan Goswami in this way. Now, Sanatan Goswami's plan to commit suicide is certainly not approved by Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. But it's not that Sanatan Goswami has done a great offense or sin by doing so. Because Sanatan Goswami's mood is important. More than the activity, the mood of a devotee is important. So Sanatan Goswami just considered himself utterly disqualified for service of the Lord. So what is the use of this body which is not meant for the service of the Lord? In that mood, he wants to give it up. It's not an egoistic or depressed state of mind in which he wants to give it up. It's also spiritual humility only in that sense. Now, next, 84th shloka. Tabe sanatana kahe, toma ke namaskare, toma gambhira hridaya ki bhujite pare. Oh Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, I offer my respects unto you. So tabe sanatana kahe, toma ke namaskare, I'm offering namaskar to you. And tomara gambhira hridaya ke bhujite pare, who can understand your deep ideas and plans that you have in your heart? So you have so many plans for me, I never knew this. Similarly, a devotee should understand that whatever we are doing is a part of Krishna's plan. It's not because of my prowess. For example, a devotee is able to do some service nicely, whether it is say singing or book distribution or cooking or worshipping the deities or speaking or writing or designing. There may be hundreds of services that a devotee managing, but one should never take credit for all of them. There's a beautiful shloka in the first canto of Bhagavatam that says that birds fly into the sky to the degree God has given them the ability to fly. Similarly, a devotee renders service to Krishna to the degree the devotee is given ability to render service. So that ability to render seva to Krishna is given by Krishna only. So there are so many proofs within Srimad Bhagavatam. Dhruva Maharaj, he could see Lord Vishnu after his 6 months of tapasya. Then he was overwhelmed with so much of love and affection for Vishnu, and he wanted to offer prayers and praise the Lord. So, but Dhruva Maharaj, as a small child, 5-year-old boy, he did not have the necessary vocabulary or experience or poetic abilities to compose verses to praise Lord Vishnu. But he wanted to praise. So Lord Vishnu took his conch shell and touched the forehead of Dhruva Maharaj. And the entire Vedic knowledge was revealed to Dhruva Maharaj within his mind. And Dhruva started offering prayers. Yontah pravishya mamavacha mimam prasuptam sanjeeva yatya khila shakti dharasvadhamnam anyamscha hasta charana shravanatvagadiyen prananamo bhagavate purushaya tubhyam. Yo antah pravishya, oh Lord, you have entered within me. Mama vacham imam prasuptam, and you have awakened my power of speech, vacham. Imam prasuptam, so far my power of speech has been sleeping. So till we engage our power of speech in Krishna's service, that power of speech is considered to be sleeping only. The real engagement of the tongue is to glorify Krishna. So otherwise it is unchaste. Tathapi kirtayam yanga yathamati yathashrutam kirtim hare swam sutkartam giram anyabhita asatim. So when we don't use our power of speech in Krishna's glorification, that power of speech is unchaste. So now Dhruva Maharaj says, yo antaha pravishya mama vacha mimam prasuptam. You have awakened my speech. Sanjeevayati. You have awakened it. Sanjeevayati means you have brought it to life. Yes, power of speech is there, it's alive. But if it's not utilized in Krishna's way, it is dead only, although it is alive. So, Sanjeevayati, Akhila Shakti Dharaha Swadhamnam. Oh Lord, you are Akhila Shakti Dharaha. You hold all kinds of energies. Swadhamnam, by your own internal spiritual potency, you have enabled me to glorify you. You have awakened my power of speech. Not only power of speech, Anyamscha, other senses also. Hasta, my hands, charana, my legs, shravana, my ears, tvagadin, my skin. You have awakened all my senses. Anyamscha hasta charana shravana tvagadin pranan namo bhagavate purushaya tubhyam. I offer my obeisances unto you, O Bhagavan, O Supreme Purusha. So in this way, Dhruva Maharaj is very beautifully offering this prayer, acknowledging that only by Krishna's grace I am even able to offer prayers to Krishna. Even our ability to offer prayer to Krishna is also given by Krishna. And the inspiration to offer prayer is also coming from Krishna. Okay, but actually Krishna creates the right kind of ambience to inspire us to perform bhakti. But we have to use our minute independence to utilize those opportunities and get inspired. He will give inspiration, but we have to take that inspiration also. So Dhruva Maharaj was willing to offer prayers to the Lord, but that ability to offer prayers to the Lord is given by the Lord. So willingness is our responsibility. Willingness is our part, and ability is given by Krishna. So Sanatana Goswami is willing to render service to Lord Chaitanya, and the ability to render service is given by Lord Chaitanya himself. And even Sanatana Goswami is also astonished. Actually, say 10 years back or 20 years back, many of us must have not have planned, oh, today we will be engaging ourselves in glorifying Krishna or in serving Krishna in all these ways. We never had a plan, but somehow some devotee intervened in our lives and then inspired us in practicing bhakti, and then we got into it, we got initiated by spiritual master, and we got so many opportunities to serve Krishna, serve the deity, serve Prabhupada in various ways, and then we are doing something now. All this is because of Krishna's grace. And our main part in this whole endeavor is we are willing to do seva to Krishna. And Krishna fanned that spark of our willingness by giving us opportunities and facilities and abilities. So, three things are required: desire, endeavor, and prayer. So, we should desire to render seva to Krishna. And we should also endeavor to the best of our ability, to the best of our God-given ability. We should endeavor to serve Krishna, but understand our endeavors are not sufficient. So we need to pray to invoke Krishna's sanction and Krishna's blessings. So we should desire, we should endeavor, and we should offer prayer. Then we will be able to do any service to Krishna. Now Sanatana Goswami is offering this prayer. So we, 84th sloka, Sanatana Goswami says, 84 to 85, यारे नाचे यारे याचे नाचा वसे ताईचे करे नृत्य नर्तने काईचे नाचे केवल नाचाया सेहर नहीं जाने. So here Sanatana Goswami says that, oh Lord, the way you make me dance, I want to dance like that. So this is, these words are spoken also by Ramananda Rai in the 8th chapter. यारे याचे नाचाओ Say taiche kare nartane. So the way you cause one dance, he dances accordingly. But how he dances and who is causing him dance, he does not know. That's how mysteriously the Lord does things. So now, okay, let me just open that shloka from the Madhya Leela. So in the Madhya Leela also, 8th chapter, Ramananda Rai speaks a very beautiful shloka about how the Lord makes his devotees dance. So Jahi Nachi Bari. So this is 8.132. I am just sharing the screen. I just opened the shloka. Raya kahe aminata tumi sutra dhar yei mata nachavo taiche nachi bar. So Ramananda Rai tells or Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, ami nata, I am just a nata. Nata means a actor. Tumi sutra dhar, I am just a dancer and you are pulling the strings. A wooden doll dances according to the person who is directing the dance. Sutradhar. Yehi mata nachao taiche nachi, chahi nachi bar. Very important point. So I wanted to focus on this chahi. Yehi mata nacha means the way you make me dance. Taiche nachi bar means I will dance accordingly. But here chahi nachi bar. Chahi means I desire to dance like that. There's a difference here. Taiche nachibar, taiche chahi nachibar means I dance and here I desire to dance. Means when a wooden puppet's strings are pulled by the puppeteer, the wooden puppet has no independence to say no. But the jiva is given independence. Krishna may be pulling string. The jiva says, I will not do. I cannot act according to your instructions. Krishna is giving instructions in the form of Bhagavad Gita, Srimad Bhagavatam and other scriptures. But the jiva says, I will not read Bhagavad Gita. I will not follow your instructions in Bhagavatam. I will not read CC. So the jiva can reject. But because the jiva has independence. But a devotee says that I have independence, but I will use my independence to align myself according to your instructions. Right? Chahi nachibar means I desire to dance according to your instructions. Please keep pulling my strings. So a devotee is one who desires to dance according to Krishna's will, according to Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu's will. So that's the greatness of a devotee's surrender. So now we did up to 84, 86. Now, Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu told Haridas Thakur, final conclusion. This gentleman wants to destroy another's property. One who is interested with another's property does not use it for one's own purposes. So now, here Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu kind of taunts our Sanatana Goswami by speaking about him to our Haridas Thakur. Yahe yaiche nachao seit. Okay, not this is over. Haridas kahe prabhu suna Haridas. Parayara dravya iho chahena karite vinash. So he is destroying another's property. So basically there is a glorification in this kind of fault finding. So he is only appreciating the humility of Sanatana Goswami. That he wanted to even give up life because it is not being used in Krishna's service. Parayara sthapya dravya kehana khaya vilaye nishadhira ihare yana na kahe anyai. So one who is interested with another's property does not distribute it or use it for one's own purposes. So means one should not use one's own body for one's own sense gratification also. So then tell him to not to do such unlawful thing. Then Haridas Thakur told, Haridas kahe mithya abhimana kari. Tomara gambhira hridaye bhujite na pari. Oh Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, we have mithya abhiman. We are falsely proud of our own capabilities. Actually, we cannot understand your deep intentions. We have so much of plans for Sanatana Goswami. Kona kona karya tumi kara kona dvare. Tumi na jani janaile ke hal jani te na pare. unless you inform us, who can understand what is your purpose? What have you planned for us? We don't even know, and you have a big plan that we have to execute. We don't even understand that. You should inform us. So,
yetadrisha tumi ihare kariya cha angikar eta saubhagya iha nahaya kah.
So you are a great personality. You have accepted Sanatana Goswami as yours. And no one can be fortunate as Sanatana Goswami. So thus Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu embraced Haridas Thakur and Sanatana Goswami. Here Haridas Thakur is appreciating Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, he is glorifying Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu and appreciating the good fortune of Sanatana Goswami also. We need to understand that Haridas Thakur is actually celebrating the success of Sanatana Goswami. Haridas Thakur had absolutely no tinge of envy or jealousy in his mind. Oh, Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu has planned so many things. He is sending Sanatana Goswami to Vrindavan and he is making him do all these things, bhakti, bhakti prachar and Vaishnava achar and Vaishnava kriya. And then lupta tirtha uddhar means excavating the lost holy places. So many plans. So seeing all these plans that Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu wants to accomplish through Sanatana Goswami, Haridas Thakur did not feel any envy. Why this devotee is given so many opportunities to render seva, while I am not being considered for all this? He is just maybe asking me to sit here and chant Hare Krishna whole day. And he is making Sanatana Goswami big author. So Haridas Thakur is not author. He is just chanting the holy names whole day. But Sanatana Goswami became author of so many books. And he also became the founder of so many temples. So one should not just discriminate the mercy that one receives from the Lord. Lord gives different kinds of mercy, different flavors of mercy to different people. So Lord Chaitanya has given Haridas Thakur the status of Namacharya. Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu descended on this planet to spread the holy name of the Lord, and he has made Haridas Thakur as the Acharya of the holy name. And Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu also descended to spread the bhakti science, and he has made Sanatana Goswami and Rupa Goswami the author of books on bhakti. So basically the Lord allocates different services to different devotees. One should not have any superiority complex just because I am doing some attention attracting service while the other devotee service is not so attention attracting. One should not have any inferiority complex thinking that, oh, that devotee is getting more popular and I am just being in the background. So this name, fame, popularity, these are all external and temporary. What is permanent is the sincerity with which we render service to Krishna, and Krishna sees that only, and that gives us a permanent result of love of Krishna. So whatever we do, whether it is background activity or foreground activity, whether it is of a great magnitude or very small magnitude, if we do it with sincerity, Krishna likes to accept it with love and affection. Whether we are a squirrel throwing some pebbles and sand particles to make the stone bridge across the ocean, or whether we are Hanuman carrying big, big boulders, Krishna sees our heart only. Are we serving him to the best of our ability? Here we can see that Haridas Thakur and Sanatana Goswami, they don't have envy towards each other. And after some time, there is a lot of, after the Mahaprabhu goes away, there is a lot of discussion between Haridas Thakur and Sanatana Goswami. They are appreciating each other. Oh, Sanatana Goswami, you are so great because Mahaprabhu gave you so much of seva. And Sanatana Goswami glorifies Haridas Thakur. And it's not an envious glorification. Sometimes we may glorify other devotees out of our envy also. Out of our jealousy also, we may glorify other devotees. Glorification is sometimes an expression of one's own dissatisfaction that we don't have it. But actually, having envy is an indirect appreciation of another devotee. Better directly appreciate. So this devotee has this blessing, has this fortune.
That does not mean that I may not have that fortune. I can also be receiving some fortune in a different manner, which Krishna wants me to be. Somebody may be playing mridanga and kartal so nicely, I may not be able to play like that, but that's fine. You do something else, some other service which you are good at. Krishna has given different abilities to different devotees. Even this one hand also, all fingers are not same. So this like one finger is small, one finger is short, one finger is very long. So, but if all the fingers are of same size, then probably the hand cannot function properly. It doesn't look very good in a garland that you are wearing. That if all the flowers are, say, Gonda garland, marigold garland you make, and every day, same flower, top to bottom, it doesn't look very exciting. So the garland is also made of flowers of different colors, different fragrances, and different sizes and different shapes. And the garland looks very exciting. Similarly, the devotee community also needs devotees of different categories, different abilities, different tastes and natures to render a very wonderful service to Krishna. And receiving all these flavors of service, Krishna would be very ecstatic. So we are all meant to please Krishna. We are not meant to be developing any pride or envy, or developing any superiority complex or inferiority complex, seeing other devotees. So here Haridas Thakur and Sanatana Goswami are serving as great examples. Or not Chaitanya Mahaprabhu is appreciating Sanatana Goswami in front of Haridas Thakur so much, but Haridas Thakur did not feel unhappy. And after, in another episode, we will see that Rupa Goswami comes to Haridas Thakur. They both are staying together. Lord Chaitanya comes and glorifies Rupa Goswami in so many ways. And Haridas Thakur did not feel envious. Not only that, Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu brings Sarvam Bhattacharya, Ramananda Rai, Sarvagamadhar Goswami and many other devotees in Jagannath Puri to glorify Rupa Goswami, who wrote that books called Vidagdha Madhava and Lalita Madhava. Mahaprabhu is appreciating Rupa Goswami in this way. But none of the devotees become jealous of Rupa Goswami. They said, Hari Bol, wonderful. So like that, we should never feel envious. And another important point here is, if I should not become envious, I should not become proud. When my service or my accomplishment is greater than another devotee's, I should not feel proud. When my service or my thing is not so attention attracting like other devotees, I should not feel envious. Okay. Now, when we see envy in others, when we perceive envy in others, whether they are envious or not is a different thing. If they are actually envious, that's between them and Krishna and between them and their guru. But when I perceive envy in others, before labeling the devotee as an envious person, I should check whether I have pride in my heart. Because when we are proud, we could perceive envy in others. And when we are envious, we could perceive pride in others. Oh, this person is so proud. Why are you seeing him as proud? Probably you are envious of his higher position. So we should check that. So we should check for ourselves whether there is envy within our hearts when we are seeing pride in others, whether we are proud when we are seeing envy in others. So Chaitanya Charitamrita demonstrates the examples of so many wonderful Vaishnavas who have no envy, no pride, but only pure loving service attitude towards Krishna. Okay, so this episode is a very heart-touching episode where Mahaprabhu's affection for his devotees is so wonderfully demonstrated, and also the non-envious attitude of devotees like Haridas Thakur and Sanatana Goswami also appreciated, and the humility of Sanatana Goswami. Many perspectives, we can see this beautiful pastime from multiple angles. So we just discussed around 10 shlokas today. So thank you all very much. Sri Chaitanya Charitamrita ki jai, Srila Prabhupada ki jai. I'm sorry for being late in coming. I totally forgot that I have a class today. If I did not see that WhatsApp message, I would have slept only. So sorry for that. But good that we had class. Thank you, Hare Krishna. Any questions or comments?
Thank you so much, Prabhu. Heartfelt gratitude to you for coming on the call and speaking so beautifully. Thanks for highlighting on these topics of how the jiva desires and the Lord empowers using our independence and favorable service, and the mercy comes in different flavors and devotees are of different flavors. And finally, about pride and envy, very, very beautiful, beautiful session. Thank you so much for accepting our invitation and being on the call. Our devotees who all have questions, you can unmute and ask. Thank you so much. Prabhu, also, there may be many questions, but you can tell us if you're getting late. We can end the call if it's late for you.
Okay. I can take a couple of questions, no problem, if devotees have.
Okay.
I see something on the chat box. Okay, it's not a question.
Okay,
if nobody has any question, then I can conclude the call.
Hare Prabhu, Ganva Pranam, please accept my humble obeisance. This is Ajay.
Hare Krishna Prabhu. Oh, somebody has a question.
Prabhuji, I got your point about being away from, you know, pride and, you know, not to see and not to be envious of others. The examples of you know, the Vaishnavas you are talking about from Chaitanya Charitamrita, they are the eternal associates of the Lord. However, you know, in this world where we ourselves are not so pure, and then we are surrounded by fellow devotees who are on the path of devotional progress, there are so many instances where these kind of things develop, where, you know, one may feel either proud or one may feel either envious of others. And that's because of our limitations, because, you know, we are still controlled by our modes of the material nature at different point in times. So how do we practically, you know, take this concept and try to implement in our daily lives, where we can stay away from the pride and envy, you know, in spite of having these modes of material nature impacting us one time or the other?
One way to curb this envy and pride is to associate with some humble devotees. There are some devotees in our devotee community, in whichever communities you are living, they are so simple-hearted. They are not passionate. I mean, accomplishing so many things is not wrong, but there are always some devotees in a devotee community where devotees are very simple-hearted, very humble, very gentle in their conduct, very satisfied at heart. Just seeing them, at least I learn from such devotees. Just seeing them is such a satisfying experience. Oh, this devotee has no pride, no envy. He's completely satisfied and happy. We have several devotees like that here. We have Jai Sachinandan Prabhu, he's a very great singer, but he's so humble. He's above 50 now, but he's just grooming the pathways at GEV here. And then he is so humble. Although he is so elder to us, at least 2 decades senior to us, but he doesn't show that seniority on us. He's very affectionate to us. So seeing such simple-hearted devotees, we can definitely be inspired to cultivate that non-enviousness and humility and give up pride and envy. So that's one thing. Then secondly, we should also understand the ill effects of envy and pride. If you are envious, actually envy is an indirect appreciation of the devotee, as I said in the class.
Mm-hmm.
Now, why do we envy another devotee? When we have this scarcity mentality. So when, say, 2 persons are there, mm-hmm. First person has something, second person does not have that thing, and he desires that thing. So then there is envy between them. And the second person will feel envious of first person. But if we see that first person has this, I also can have this. So if there is no scarcity mentality in us, just if there is an abundance mentality, this devotee got this opportunity to render service, instead of feeling envious of this devotee, let me relish and appreciate and acknowledge the glory of the opportunity to serve that I received. So now, why does another devotee feel, envious of this person? Because he also wants this fortune that this devotee has. So now, if you want that, you appreciate that. If you envy that, Krishna will not give you that. If you appreciate, he can give you. For example, all the gopis of Vrindavan were so appreciative of Mother Yashoda's fortune. Oh, Yashoda is directly the mother of Krishna, and she is bathing Krishna, feeding Krishna, dressing Krishna, making Krishna sleep, giving milk to Krishna, giving all kinds of milk products to Krishna, and decorating Krishna with nice ornaments and turban and then dots and all that. So Yashoda is so fortunate. All the gopis were thinking that if we also get such an opportunity to serve Krishna like Mother Yashoda is doing, we will be very fortunate. But they never envied Mother Yashoda. They only appreciated Mother Yashoda. They appreciated that her glorious position of rendering such intimate service to Krishna. So Krishna noticed their heartfelt desire. And Krishna fulfilled their desires also during the Brahma Vimohana Leela. For one full year, Krishna appeared in the form of their own sons and received all the services from these gopis, just as he received from Mother Yashoda. So when we appreciate another devotee's good fortune, when we really feel happy for that devotee, and when we sincerely desire to render a service similar to that devotee, then Krishna will give us that opportunity. But if you envy the devotee, try to pull down the devotee, try to just kind of dampen the enthusiasm of the devotee by sharp words or harsh words or envious glances, then Krishna will not be appreciating that. Now another point is, why did that devotee get that good fortune? Because Krishna sanctioned it. Not a blade of grass moves without Krishna's sanction, isn't it? So when the devotee is getting that good fortune, Krishna has sanctioned it. So if Krishna has sanctioned it, who am I to oppose? Krishna has sanctioned something for the devotee and I am feeling envious, means I am going against Krishna's desire. I am going against Krishna's plan or Krishna's sanction or Krishna's blessing on the devotee. And how can I go against Krishna? So understanding all these things, we should consciously give up this envy. Same is the case with pride. Pride also has a longer discussion. As I discussed very elaborately during the class, whatever we are accomplishing is only because Krishna has allowed us to do it. Krishna has blessed us to do it. That means what? We should have no reason to be proud. Why should I be proud? Krishna has done something through my hands, of course. Krishna has done something through me. That does not mean I feel proud. The credit goes to Krishna. If I take credit, I will become proud. If I transfer credit to Krishna, I will not become proud. So we need to learn to transfer the credit of our activities and accomplishments to Krishna and Guru and other Vaishnavas who supported us. Mm-hmm. If you learn to transfer credit to other devotees, then we need not become proud. And actually, if you read scriptures, we will become humble. We will not become proud. So people who are not in good consciousness, they may become proud of their scriptural knowledge. But people who are in the right consciousness, by reading scriptures, they will become totally humble. Roma Harshan Sutta is very proud. So Balaramji just killed him. But if you read the scriptures and understand, oh, I am a spirit soul, supposed to be serving Krishna, supposed to be in the company of Krishna in the spiritual realm, and I am entrapped in this material body, in this material world. So, I mean, if I understand it properly, I should feel totally humbled and awkward and humiliated than feeling proud. So our knowledge of scripture should make us humble. Oh, I am just so fallen in this material world. I need to perform bhakti and go back to the spiritual world. So instead of comparing our current situation with the situation where we are supposed to be, we are comparing our current material situation with another devotee's current material situation and feeling a sense of superiority. Oh, my situation is little better than this fellow. No, where am I supposed to be? I'm supposed to be in Krishna's company. I'm entrapped in this material world.
Yeah.
So how can that make me proud? That should make me humble, right? But you are not having the right benchmark to compare ourselves or to evaluate ourselves. We are evaluating ourselves depending on where do we stand in this community of devotees, right? In the community of so many people around us, am I more accomplished? Am I more eloquent in my speech? Am I more melodious in my singing? Am I more efficient in my managing? Am I more beautiful in my looks? Am I more attention attracting with my activities? So, I'm better than these fellows. So I'm great. I'm superior. So that's a very awkward thing to do. Although it happens with us, but if we analyze all these things, if we remember all these things, certainly there is no reason for us to feel proud. Does it make sense, Prabhu?
Yeah, Prabhu, totally. I mean, I agree with your point. And thank you for such an elaborate answer. I have one follow-up question here that, you know, putting the situation in the reverse order where, you know, because of the need of the situation or the ability or, you know, the nature of the service, certain devotees around you, you know, they start saying, oh, Prabhu, you got this, you know, you are so fortunate. Although it's like praise, but as you said, this praise is coming as a form of envy, you know, repeatedly.
That's in all cases. Sometimes it may be.
Yeah. So sometimes it's become, you know, like a bitter in the, you know, the relationship or you, how do we, you know, deal with such kind of devotees so that, you know, we still collaborate and work with them with a healthy relationship. At the same time, you know, they automatically understand that, you know, that they will also come to the same point, you know, as they progress. So,
okay. It's a little difficult. It's not that easy.
Yeah.
So although we know the highest philosophy, sometimes the emotions or the words or the glances of others could affect us.
Yeah.
So Hiranyaksha, when he was fighting with Varahadev, he spoke very harsh words to Varahadev. So Bhagavatam says that Varahadev was pained at heart hearing the blasphemous words of Hiranyaksha. Okay. So we are all having emotions. We have feelings. We are not stones to be indifferent to other people's glances or other people's activities or words or comments or feedbacks. But we need to take it for our purification. Okay.
Sure.
Even if we are innocent and other people are commenting on us, even if we do some sincere service and other people are throwing envious glances or some tantrums on us, we need to take it for our purification. And if Krishna is criticized by Dwarakavasis, who am I to be spared by people around me?
Sure.
And actually Krishna is innocent. He was blamed as a thief of Samantakamani, but Krishna is innocent and he proved his innocence eventually. But we may not be innocent. Probably in that particular situation, we might be innocent. Okay. We may not have done any mistake and we are just kind of commented upon by some devotee in that context. But we must have done something like that in the past to someone else. And we are receiving that reaction now. So we need to see from that perspective. Tattena kampam susamikshamanam bhunjana evatma kratam vipakam. So actually, even if I am dealt with inappropriately, still Bhagavatam teaches us to see it in a proper light as an opportunity meant for our own purification and not develop any envy or grudge or anger on other devotees. We may have to deal with it externally. Externally, we may have to address the situation, but internally, we need to reconcile that I am experiencing this bitter situation because of my own past misdeed. Suniti was experiencing so much of pain because of Suruchi's activities. Not only she, at one point, Suruchi started insulting Dhruva also. What did Suniti say? The first thing that she said was, oh, my dear son, Dhruva, never desire any harm for Suruchi or anyone who must have hurt you. First point. Second point, whatever difficulties or pains that we are experiencing are results of our own past deeds. She was not even saying that today Suruchi insulted you, she will definitely reap the consequences of her activities tomorrow. That's not her point.
Yeah.
Suniti is saying that I did some mistake. That's why I'm experiencing the pain of my husband's neglect. Dhruva, you are also experiencing the pain because you must have done something before. The third thing that she said was, whatever desire you may have, worship the Supreme Lord, Krishna. So the first two things did not register in Dhruva's head. The third thing registered in his head. Okay, whatever I desire, I can worship the Lord. He went outside the kingdom and then he started doing tapasya under the guidance of Narada. So we are not that innocent. When we are blamed also, I mean, you may be innocent, I am not innocent. Okay, when somebody blames me, right, I take it as for my own purification, I must have done something wrong. In some other context, if not in this context, probably in this context also I may be wrong. But even if I am completely innocent in this context, I must have done something wrong in the past or in the past lives. I may receive reaction now in this way. So we should take it for our purification, but externally address the situation if multiple people are getting affected. On a personal level, we may tolerate. But if other person's misbehavior is affecting multiple people, we may have to address the situation. Does it make sense, Prabhu?
Thank you so much, Prabhu, for the nice. Yeah. Thank you so much. Hare Krishna.
I'm speaking very softly because others are sleeping.
Okay. You're loud and clear enough. Thank you.
Should we end the call? Any other comments?
Yeah. Do you have time for another question or do you need to go?
Okay, you can ask.
Okay. First, let me just confirm my understanding that you said that if you're feeling some pride, then it's a symptom of you're having some envy in your heart, and also vice versa. If you're feeling envy, then that's a symptom that you have some pride in your heart. Was that correct?
I said, if we perceive envy in others, we need to check if there is any pride in our hearts. And if we perceive pride in others, we need to check if there is any envy in our hearts.
Okay, yeah, that makes perfect sense.
Yeah,
yeah, perfect sense.
May or may not be. The other person may or may not be proud or envious, and we may or may not be proud or envious, but this check is good.
Yes, yes, that's beautiful point. Beautiful point. I love it.
Concluding that we are envious.
Excuse me?
Anything else?
Yeah, just one other thing. When we hear that, the Goswamis were instructed to excavate the holy places and the deities, does that mean that they were, those holy places that were inaccessible, were they like literally underground and needed to be dug up? Or in what way were they actually inaccessible? Do we know this?
I'm not sure exactly what it is, but they are there, but they are not popularly visible to the common people. Just like Mahaprabhu went to Radhakund. He was searching for Radhakund. It must be somewhere here only, but it's somewhere in some agricultural fields. Mahaprabhu said, oh, here is the point. Then later, his disciples, Goswamis excavated and then made a nice pond there. So the places were there. It's not, may or may not be underground, that I don't know the detail. But they are there. But they are not revealed. They are forgotten.
Okay, Prabhu. Thank you so much for a wonderful class.
Thank you,
Prabhu. I know it's extremely late. So if everyone is okay, we can end the call. Thank you very much. Thank you for your valuable association. We can pay our obeisances to Prabhuji. Vancha kalpataru vyascha kripa sindhu pyevacha.
Namo namaha.
Ananda koti vaishnavrandu ki jai.
Prabhu
ki jai.
Jai.
Ramrat ki jai. His grace. Jai. Darshan Prabhuji ki jai.
Jai.
Thank you.
Thank you so much.
Thank you, Prabhuji. Hare Krishna.
Thank you, Prabhuji. Hare Krishna.
Thank you, Prabhu. Hare Krishna.
Thank you, Prabhuji. Hare Krishna.